Well, welcome. Good morning, everybody. For those who happen to be watching from a long distance away and who may just have dropped in, my name's Andrew. I'm the minister for the parish of Albury in united benefice of Shear, Albury and Chilworth. And a very warm welcome to you, whether you are watching live now or whether you're watching on the recording later on. It's great to share this time together. Special welcome to Shear folk joining us, and it's good to be able to return the blessing you gave us 2 or 3 weeks ago when we joined you for a service last month. And incidentally, don't worry if you've not had a service order to download and you're used to having one. The words will be on the screen, so that's all fine. So let's sing our first hymn, maybe with harvest still in our minds, also putting us in the mood for a service which is centred around a story of celebration. The hymn is helped by the singers of St. Martin in the Fields, who've made their music available to the wider church. Fill your hearts with joy and gladness. So as we begin our service, let us pray. God, our judge and saviour, teach us to be open to your truth and to trust in your love, that we may live each day with confidence in the salvation which is given through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God opens the way for us to build up contact with him in praise and worship, but also, most amazingly, fellowship. And all shared relationships depend on openness and trust and a willingness to turn back when we have wronged the other and we wrong God all too easily. Yet he himself opens the way back. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let us then show our love for him by confessing our sins in penitence and faith. The words will come on the screen. We confess to you our lack of care for the world you have given us. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We confess to you our selfishness in not sharing the earth's bounty fairly. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We confess to you our failure to protect resources for others. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We sing again, God forgave my sin in Jesus' name, the song Freely, Freely. Bible reading, and Caroline Evans has very kindly done this from Shear.
The reading is taken from Matthew chapter 22, starting at verse 1. The parable of the wedding banquet. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to tell those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, 'Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened cattle have been butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burnt their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find." So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. He asked, "How did you get in here without wedding clothes, friend?" The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, "Tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Have you seen the election debates from America? I've actually not watched. I haven't been strong enough, I don't think. I've seen highlights. I've seen the undisputed star, the fly on Mike Pence's hair. I've seen some of the comic takeoffs. Two parties struggling for control, each hoping to land a killer blow on the other. 2 weeks ago in both Shear and Albury, we heard how the chief priests and the elders came and picked a verbal scrap with Jesus as he taught in the temple courts. They're hoping to land a killer blow. In their heads, this is a struggle for control. They feel they've got to win. But Jesus is awkward because he doesn't play by those rules. He won't make control his highest value. He invites, he doesn't command. It's generosity of love against protection of the system. Faith lived in action against confidence in the system. And the people look on and ask themselves, who's right? The temple authorities asked, "By what authority do you do these things?" in that reading of 2 weeks ago. Jesus had entered Jerusalem accepting praise as Messiah. He'd ejected the money changers from the temple, and now he was standing there teaching. "Come on, Jesus, what makes your control better than our control?" When Jesus asked them for a verdict on John the Baptist, their anxiety for control left them exposed. And whatever they answered, they feared that, well, really just like an election candidate, the wrong answer would leave them exposed and play badly. So they evaded. And having exposed that, Jesus followed up with three parables in which the temple authorities can easily recognize the villains, them. And it wasn't just biting back. If they were willing to hear, these parables were a series of warnings in which they could question how they were seeing things. And the people watch all this as we watch now. And Caroline read to us the third of those parables. "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son." So here is a time of joy. It's the fulfillment of a long-awaited dream. One day heaven will come to earth and all things will be made new. How wonderful to be invited to that. Now, I used to work for a local authority. And sometimes we had to organise official functions. And they ran the range from a few sandwiches after an official opening to grand affairs in which a splendidly dressed master of ceremonies would take your invitation at the doorway and shout into the room things like, "Mr. and Mrs. Olmiates and their daughter, Eve." It might surprise you to know that these weren't done just to have a good knees up at the expense of council taxpayers. They were often community events, and they could be a bit of a pain for the organising team, otherwise known as the mayor's secretary. One of the biggest pains was when people didn't reply to the invitation. So you had no idea how many were coming, how many you were catering for. And it was surprising how often those with the biggest authority were the ones who didn't reply. It's not a new problem. Everybody listening to Jesus tell the story that Caroline's just read would have had some idea of what ignoring the invitation meant in rudeness and wasted food. And the king would have sent out word months in advance, save the day, come to the great wedding feast, we'll write a new chapter together. Weddings are for celebrating. And at the moment, people can't throw big parties. Lots of people are deciding to have a party later. And that, of course, isn't compulsory. But God is a party giver. And the wedding in the parable stands for the time of fulfillment when God will celebrate his Son and the coming together of heaven and earth. So the king has sent out his save the dates, and now he sends out messengers on the day to say, come, it's all ready, and nobody bothers. Their minds are all on the life in front of them, on their farms, their businesses. They won't look at what's offered. It is a huge insult, and most listeners to Jesus would have expected a fierce reaction. But the king in Jesus' story gives the guests another chance. He tries again, and this time they kill the messengers. Let's call the ungrateful guests the unreachables. The prime unreachables were the chief priests and the Pharisees, who were not listening to the meaning behind what Jesus was saying. So, am I off the hook? I'm not a chief priest. I've not killed any messengers lately. And with the benefit of massive hindsight, I'm on Jesus' side in all this. So, I'm all right, aren't I? Let's think about how Jesus went on. The king sends out a new invitation. Everyone is invited. Anywhere the messengers can find them, literally from verse 10, the good and the bad, and very likely the ugly. Let's call this lot of guests the unexpected. Here's an interesting thing. If you read the book of Genesis and the prophets in the Bible, you will see that God's goodness to Israel was always meant to bless the whole world. It was never plan A, bless just Israel, and plan B, if they won't have it, then bless the riffraff. It was always Israel will be blessed, but through Israel, the whole world will be blessed. Somewhere along the way, the strand of Israelite thinking, represented by the chief priests and the Pharisees, had forgotten that. And in their heads, the only invited guests were people like them. And they were already in their heads. And they don't like the way that Jesus has first of all equated them with the messenger murderers, and has now taken their sense of exclusivity and shredded it. They're seething. And how am I doing with that? Am I ever tempted to think that God only wants people just like me? Could I take it if the good and the bad and the ugly, the unexpected, started trying to come in? The fact is, I am one of the unexpected. So let's see how Jesus went on. It's a man without a wedding robe. The king confronts him, and verse 13, he's chucked into the outer darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. And I can never read that verse without thinking of the 1960s comedian Dave Allen telling the story of the old fire and brimstone Irish priest who is shouting at his congregation that unless they repent, there will be a weeping and a wailing and a gnashing of teeth. And there's an old lady in the congregation who pipes up, "But I haven't got any teeth." And he shouts back, "Teeth will be provided." What this man without the robe, without the wedding clothes, has done is that he's not respected the king's invitation. He's not even thought about the sheer goodwill that the king is showing to him. Everyone else has gone and washed and changed, and he's basically not bothered. He's gone on doing what he was doing, and then he thinks he can just wander along to the party. Let's call him the unresponsive. If I am invited by the King of Kings to share in his joy as heaven meets earth, should I treat that invitation as if it was just the chance of a quick half in the local? Back to the authorities. They saw their challenge to Jesus as a power struggle. And that struggle was played out for keeps just a few days later when they didn't confront Jesus just with words. Jesus didn't meet it with words, but with acted out love as he took upon himself the malice and evil of the world and went to the cross. When we honour the fact that my and your invitation was bought at the price of Jesus' life, that's when we put on the wedding robe, the wedding clothes. We've done nothing for it. We can't do good works that will pay for it. All we can do is let God into our lives, and then he works in us with his life by his Spirit. To paraphrase St. Paul, I now have the life of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. We're just people who've been drafted in from the streets. We're riffraff. But we can open ourselves to God. And by his Spirit, we are enabled to live his life in everyday action. We can love the people God made. We can take care of his world. We can seek first his kingdom. How will that work out for you and for me this coming week in everyday life? Let's pray. Lord, thank you that you have invited us to your wedding feast. May we, the unexpected, be the responsive. As we bring our lives before you, fill us, take us, live through us, wherever we may find ourselves. Amen. The prophet Isaiah once wrote to God's people, assuring them of their release from exile in the future. You shall go out with joy. But his words are great to sing whenever we look to freedom. At the marriage feast of the Son of God, the world will finally be free of evil and death. And we sing, you shall go out with joy. Again from St. Martin in the Fields, one verse only, I'm afraid.
Trees of the field shall clap, their hands, and the trees of the field.
Richard Floyd is going to lead us in our intercessions.
Let us pray. Few things can be more devastating for a family, and particularly for a mother, than to lose a baby or a young child. Today is the third day of Baby Loss Awareness Week. Pray for those who bring about this week's events and the many charities that support them, those who work to mitigate grief and loneliness and to prevent unnecessary child death. And we remember those who suffer. We pray for peace in the world, for the people of the United States as they prepare for the forthcoming presidential election. We pray especially for the people of Yemen, one of the poorest of Arab countries, devastated by years of civil war, bringing famine, disease, homelessness, and desperate suffering and numerous deaths. We pray for relief for a people weakened by malnutrition, cholera, and conflict, and who, on top of all these miseries, are left particularly vulnerable to the COVID crisis. We pray for an end of strife and relief for their suffering. We pray for the sick, for those in fear of infection, and all in special need of our prayers. We pray for Her Majesty the Queen and all in authority under her. Guide her ministers and their advisors as they battle to contain coronavirus epidemic while supporting the economy and continuing the ordinary duties of their station. We pray for your church throughout the world, for all bishops and clergy, for the people of our parish, and for those who work and worship here. We will say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory for ever and ever. Amen.
Our final hymn, with the help of the Northern Baptist Association in the UK, is O Jesus, I Have Promised.
Bye.
as you go out to serve in the name and with the life of Christ. May you indeed know he is near, now and forever, till heaven meets earth and beyond. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you forever. Amen.